The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنِ وَعَلَّمَهِ. The best of you are those who learn the Qur'an and share the knowledge, teach it to others. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-Qur'an يَأْتِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ شَفِيعًا لِأَصْحَابِهِ. The Qur'an will come in the day of judgment as the strongest evidence for the Muslim, for us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from them. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that every single letter of the Qur'an is a good deed. And in the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, for those who neglect and ignore and turn back to Allah, يَوَدُّ أَحَدُهُمْ, they would like to save themselves even بِمِلْءِ الْأَرْضِ ذَهَبًا وَلَوْ افْتَدَى بِهِ. Yeah? Even the whole earth full of gold, to get that, say, you know, one good deed to make them go into the right side, into Allah's, you know, good people's side. But they won't be accepted from them. So as the scholars say, this life, Allah reward per atoms. فَأَمَّا مَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّ. An atom's weight, you get rewarded. You come in the hereafter, a whole earth full of good deeds will not be accepted. Time over, time's up. Yeah? It's like, as we said, you know, you go in a game, you score during the 90 minutes, if you play soccer, football, you score during the 90 minutes, it's counted. After the game leaves the field, you take the ball and kick it in the net 100 times. Doesn't count. It has to be during the time of test, the time of trial, which is this life. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easier for us to always come to the masjid. May Allah make it easier for us to walk to the masjid, to populate the masjid. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. The true believers, those who truly believe in Allah, believe that they're going to stand before Allah on Akhira, they keep the masjid alive. They are the people of the masjid. Another one, the Prophet ﷺ say, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُ الرَّجُلِ يَعْتَادَ الْمَسَاجِدِ فَاشْهَدُهُ لَهُ بِالْإِيمَانِ. If you see the person regular to the masjid, bear witness, he is not only a Muslim, he is a believer. He's a true believer. May Allah make us from them. And we started a few weeks back the Surah Al-Baqarah, one of the most amazing Surah of the Quran. It's the longest Surah, 286 ayahs. 286 ayahs, full of miracles, full of stories, full of wisdom, full of, you know, ruling, amazing. Given 1,400 years ago to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who didn't know how to read or write. And nowadays scholars will sit down with the universities writing books and books and books that will fill a whole room about this surah. So inshallah we just reflect on it, take some, you know, lesson from it. And we already finished the first few ayahs, which it begins by Allah, begins by Alif Lam Mim. Yeah, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. We've finished that the last time, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begin by Alif Lam Mim, and only Allah knows what does it mean. ذلك الكتاب, this book is the only thing on the face of the earth that has no doubts. It's the only thing on the face of the earth that will save you. It's the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hudan, it has guidance only للمتقين. You can't just give the Quran to anybody. You can't say, oh brother, maybe he's interested, he give them the Quran. It will not benefit those who have no taqwa. Taqwa means they have the desire to protect themselves. They are seeking, they are searching to protect themselves from evil, from lying, from cheating. They have that, that's muttaqin. Taqwa is to protect yourself from all evil. If somebody is so decent and he's searching, says this universe, it can't be an accident. It can't be the only thing. There must be some creator behind, must be wisdom behind. That person is worthy of the Qur'an, and the Qur'an will be guidance for them. But if the person will go and study in this university or that university to critique the Qur'an, oh, they will find in every page something that will send them away from the Qur'an. Allah says, يهدي به كثيرا ويضل به كثيرا. The Quran itself will guide so many and also will lead so many others to misguidance. Why? The point of view, the attitude you come to the Quran with. If you come to the Quran with an attitude that you are a slave and this is the master's speech, then you will benefit. If you come to the Quran and says, but we are in 2016, this doesn't make sense here now. We are in New Zealand. This may be benefit in Arabia. If that attitude, if you are putting yourself with a pin to mark, you're putting yourself above Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates nothing more than somebody with arrogance, with the attitude problem. You know, every few hours Allah says to us, come and says, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ. Yeah, we are slave, we worship you. We come to worship you. Every few hours we stand in front of Allah and says, we are slave. So when those people go for da'wah, we're not inviting people to prestigious lifestyle. No, we're inviting them to be slave. But slave to Allah alone. At the moment, slave to everything else. Slave to money, slave to the fashion industry, slave to, you know, the neighborhood style, slave to, you know, the, whatever it is going, the trend. But when you come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all you care about is your soul and your heart and your character. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابِ لَا رَيْبَ فِي هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. And then Allah describes al-muttaqeen. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. Three things describe those who Allah loves. Number one, they believe the promise of Allah. They trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's word and promise, which is ghaib, it's unseen for them. Yeah? Well, to protect it and revive it and refresh it, يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ. So establishing the prayer, keeping that contact with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will strengthen your iman, will make your iman strong. Nothing will make you doubt what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised. What is the solution? Salah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describe it. وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ. But inside this يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ, it's using the plural form. يُقِيمُونَ. They do the salah together. It's very nice and subtle hint that Muslims should not be individual. Muslims are jama'ah, Muslims are together, Muslims are united. So you don't say, you know, you pray at home and you come to the masjid in Eid, come to the masjid in Ramadan. The further you are from the masjid, the further you are from the community, the lower your iman will go. Your iman bil ghaib will just, we watered down. So in the same ayah it says, يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ. Allah says, from whatever we provided them. Not everybody has money, but some people have wisdom, have knowledge, have energy, have time, have experience, have knowledge. Allah says, whatever Allah chose you for, you need to share it. As I believe in Allah, not for any other reason. The intention, the reason why I'm building the fence, why I'm helping the kids playing soccer, why I'm fixing the whatever it is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sake. If the people say, thank you brother, jazakallah, mashallah, it's fine. If they didn't say, it's still fine. But if somebody is doing it for wrong intention, after a few times of not being appreciated, they disappear. They just say, nobody appreciates my work. What are you talking about? Allah is paying you already. The appreciation comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah appreciates an atom's weight. Every step, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, every single step you take for Allah's sake, Allah appreciates it amazingly, amazingly. There will be a special invitation for every time you go to the masjid. من غدا إلى المسجد أو راح عد الله له في الجنة نزلا كلما غدا أو راح. The Prophet ﷺ said, not only each way to the masjid and back, Allah will prepare for you a celebration, a prize for each way. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did. So the idea is, وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. They just do it for Allah's sake. The Prophet ﷺ said to help us also that the people appreciation, the Prophet calls it عاجل بشرى المؤمن. If the people love you for Allah's sake. If the people appreciate you and when they see you, they're happy, it's nothing about showing off. Shaitan will come to you and says, oh, maybe you're showing off. Maybe, you know, because of you're doing it for your own ego, for your own name, for your own reputation. Say, no, no, no. My intention at the beginning was for Allah's sake. If the people come and say thank you, it's a sign from Allah that it is actually accepted. Yeah? If you do something for Allah's sake and the people love you for it, it's a good sign. It's a good sign. The people used to go out in the streets when they hear that there's a sahaba is coming through. In the old days, countries like Egypt, they didn't have many sahabi. The sahabi came from Arabia and they came to Egypt. Amr ibn al-As and a few others. The people used to stand in the street just to just have a look. So that it was a sign from Allah that they have been accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَا مُنْفِقُونَ Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَىٰ هُدًى وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُتَّقُونَ Allah says, definitely, those people who achieve this, believe in promise, establishing the salah, sharing what Allah gives them, if you have this, Allah says, Allah confirmed that these are truly guided. These are real guided, not anything else. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُتَّقُونَ And they are the truly pious people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that about them. Then, so this is Surah Al-Baqarah. It begins by describing the believer, then it will describe the disbeliever, then it will describe the in-between. Then it says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا Surely, certainly, no doubt, those who reject Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, reject the message. Imagine 1,400 years ago, imagine just the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the best da'i, the best one that can give da'wah, the best one that can speak. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with the best message, with the Quran, and they still reject him. He wouldn't give up sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah told him, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ Those who reject you, سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَنذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ It is the same for them. You warn them, or you don't warn them, they will not believe. Because of arrogance, because of they reject Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because they say he's an orphan, he doesn't have noble, you know, fathers and richness and money, why doesn't go to so and so? And they actually say that, why doesn't Quran come to this tribe or that tribe? That is the reason for rejecting the message. Allah says, for them, they will not look at the miracles or the signs or the verses. No, no, no. They have different. Attitude. Allah says, don't even try. سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ It's equal to them. أَنذَرْتَهُمْ You warn them or you don't warn them. لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ What is the punishment? خَاتَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ وَعَلَىٰ سَمْعِهِمْ وَعَلَىٰ أَبْصَارِهِمْ Allah says, their heart is sealed from accepting the guidance. Their heart, their soul, the self, you know, the feeling of being related to the Prophet ﷺ is gone. Not only that, خَتَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ وَعَلَىٰ سَمْعِهِمْ They don't hear the advice. You talk to them, and they're not actually listening. They are thinking of how to apply. It's not like you're listening and taking notes and thinking about what is being said. No, they're not thinking about what's being said. They're thinking how to debunk, how to reply, how to win the debate. Allah calls that, they don't hear anything. Allah says they don't hear. They have the ears, they have the system, but they're not actually benefiting from the message. And that's a very scary for those who keep moving away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they can actually lose the effect of the Quran, of the advice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's why you need to keep always attached, always say, for my iman's sake, I need to. Wallahi, today, we have the, you know, the kids class, age 10 to 12. 10 to 12, and Saad was one of them, and Biza, I was saying to them, one question about sacrifice. you know, this definition of things in the Quran, qurbani and sacrifice and jannah, and yeah. And I said to them, give me example. Give me example of sacrifice. Yeah, we all, mashallah, very talented kids, they also sacrifice money and time and energy and, you know, what you even, they say, you sacrifice what you like, what Allah likes. If it is not appropriate, if it is not good. One of them said, the best sacrifice is to live all your life and die as a Muslim. He says, that is a sacrifice. That you have consistent, you have the whole from beginning to end. It's not just on and off. It's not optional. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punishes someone and they just don't have the feeling for Islam anymore, they just don't hear the message anymore, that's not a good thing. It's punishment. Allah says, وَعَلَىٰ أَبْصَارِهِمْ غُشَاوَىٰ. They don't see what you see. They don't see the blessing in the clouds or the colors and the beautiful, you know, wisdom in all the things around us. They don't see that. If it rains, it's a very bad day. You know? If they have 5 minute argument with somebody, they will just be miserable the whole day. They say it's not a bad day, it's only a bad 5 minute. You know? They had, you know, an issue and that's whole affected all their life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, these people are not benefiting from the signs. Not only that, وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ. They will have painful punishment. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from them. This one ayah does not apply to people today, by the way. This ayah, it says, سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ. It is equal for them. You warn them, you don't warn them, they will never believe. We cannot judge anybody with this ayah. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that took this judgment on the people that reject the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's why these Muslims come every day, you know? New River, people come to Islam every day. So as a Muslim, you should never ever give up. You don't say, oh, sawa'un alayhim, this is the same. No. This ayah applied to those people who openly rejected the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and says, no, we will never believe you, we will fight you till we die. And they declare so many wars on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then the ayah, so very small ayah about the kuffar. Then so many ayah comes about those who are not kuffar. They're actually hypocrites. They faked Islam for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They faked it. They pretended to be Muslim at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ. Among people, مَنْ يَقُولُ. They will say with their tongue, آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ. We believe. Just to blend in. You know, we're Muslim. Just to blend in, just to defend, to protect themselves. To be part of the Jama'ah, just to be part of the group. But in their heart, they don't like what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees. They don't like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's command. They will say it. They will keep saying it, showing off. Amanna billahi wa bil yawm al akhir. Allah says, wa ma hum bi mu'mineen. They are not believers. They are liars. They're not true. يخادعون الله. They think they can deceive Allah or Allah's cause. You know, Allah's cause is the religion of Islam, the believers, the Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Sahaba. So those hypocrites, they try to deceive the Sahaba, deceive the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah says in the Quran, من أهل المدينة مرضوا على النفاق لا تعلمهم. Allah ya'lamhum. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't know them. Even the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't know some of them. Allah says to them, there is some of them are fake. They're not true believers. You don't know them. Allah knows them. In this ayah, Allah exposing them, says they don't believe. They're just deceiving the Muslim. But Allah says, وَمَا يَخْدَعُونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ. They only deceive themselves. As a matter of fact, they're not deceiving anybody else. They're only deceiving themselves. So if somebody is just praying because especially for the young one, it's only the mother's looking, or if the mother is in the house, or the father in the house, they pray. If they're not in the house, they don't pray. They think they're tricking the father, they're tricking the mother to be, oh, what a nice boy. Allah says they're only tricking themselves, because they're actually shutting the door of hell. So all of us should have Allah as number one, not the mother, not the father. Even for us as fathers here and the mothers in other room, make Allah number one. Don't make yourself number one for the kids. Allah is number one. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam should be before us. He said, this is the sunnah. This is the Quran. You do it to please Allah. You do it to have the help of Allah. You do it to be like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam team. Not because fearing me or respecting me or obeying me. No, no, no. Give me number three. You have to have respect to your parents, but number one should be Allah. So wherever they may be, in a house, at school, in the street, in a different city, they will believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, they will have some of these people that used to pretend. Among the Sahaba, they will say, amanna billah, we believe in Allah, we believe in Akhira. Allah says, no, they're not. They only doing it to deceive you. They have no realization that they actually deceiving themselves. Who are, some scholars say, this ayah should not pass through quickly. You have to ask yourself. Every one of us have to ask himself or herself, am I one of these people? If I lived at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, would I be so sincere, strong, supporting the cause and helping the Prophet and the Sahaba, or involving those who making money from it? Is very very difficult question, but every Muslim should think about it. Because the true believers, they always fear that. They always fear that Allah will reject them, says, you are just showing off. You're not true religious, you're not true believers. Even Abu Bakr, the best Muslim after the Prophet, the best Muslim, he actually asked himself the same question, am I one of them? Am I fake? Is my iman is 100%? He made the prophets laugh. When he went to the Prophet ﷺ and said to the Prophet, O Messenger of Allah, I think I'm a hypocrite. The Prophet ﷺ said, the iman, the faith, the belief of the whole billions of Muslims, not equal to your belief, even if they add them all together, not equal to the iman of Abu Bakr. Why are you saying that? He says, because when I'm with you, O Messenger of Allah, it's like I see Jannah with my own eyes. I can see it. But when I leave you and go home, go to my shop, go to my business, I'm just dealing in, you know, transaction and money and dunya. I forget about the, you know, this image in my head. He says, Abu Bakr, sa'atan wa sa'a. There is time for business and transaction and even play and laugh and sleep and eat and drink. And there's time for praying and the masjid. If you stay in the same state, the Prophet ﷺ said to him, if you stay in the same state, seeing the Jannah like you see it here with me, the angel will be standing on the side of the street shaking hand with you. You will be in Jannah already. But dunya, it is time for ibadah, time for study, time for business, time for sleep, time for play and laugh. And yeah, it's fine. It's Islam. And you get a good deed when you laugh and play with your, you know, family. You get a good deed when you work and earn money. You get a good deed when you study and go to school. In Islam, 24/7, you get a good deed when you go to sleep. The angel keep writing for you. Even you're going to sleep for 7-8 hours, but you're going to sleep after you prayed your Isha. When you're going to sleep, you make wudu. When you go to sleep, you say Bismillah. You put your like the Prophet ﷺ, sleep on your right hand side. Yeah? Bismika Rabbi Amut wa Ahya. You just say this single word, oh Allah, in your name, I woke up, in your name, I'm going to sleep. By your protection, by your, you know, power. You're going to sleep? The Prophet ﷺ said, whoever goes to sleep on tahara, on pure, which means make wudu, Allah will send an angel to stay with him all night, making dua. Giving a good deed, making dua, and says, Allahumma akfir lahu, Allahumma arhamhu, Allahumma akfir lahu. You are snoring, and the angel is working. Angel, honorable creation of Allah. If they told us some nice old sheikh coming to make dua for you, oh, we will travel to see the sheikh. This is better than 1,000 sheikh, an angel, for free. All you do, if you break your wudu, or if you have janaba, take a shower and fall asleep. That is the huge reward for every one of us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about those people who fake their iman, lie at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, thinking they're clever, Allah says they're not clever. فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٍ. The fact is, they have a disease in the heart. What is the disease? Trying to gain rewards from other than Allah. They're trying to gain rewards from other than Allah. If they're sincere, they get the rewards straight from Allah. You get paid from Allah straight. But if you want to show off, for people to say, MashaAllah, he's MashaAllah, and the people say it, who are you losing? You know, you imagine this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is willing to pay, and you say, no. I like, you know, this guy and this family. No. Allah said, there is a sickness in the heart. The soul is not strong. فَزَادَهُمُ اللَّهُ مَرَضًا وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْذِبُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of these lies they've made, increase their, you know, sickness, increase their, you know, distance away from Him. Allah doesn't like people who are arrogant or who are false, we call them. Munafiq. Munafiq is hypocrite. He has two faces. One face, you know, in front of the people, one face behind the people. Because he fears the people, he respects the people, he worries about the what the people say. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from them. وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ, if it was said to those people, لَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ, if it was said to them, don't cause problem, don't cause corruption. Because the scholars say, whatever you do that is not sincere, even if it's a good deed, it's corruption on earth. Whatever you do, even if it's a good deed, without sincerity, without seeking Allah's pleasure, it's actually corruption, it's not good at all. So Allah says, for those people at the time of the Prophet ﷺ in Medina, there were so many hypocrites. Islam became very strong. They just want to join the winning team. So they joined the Muslim for dunya benefit, or just to protect themselves, or to become just a helper to the enemies. So Allah says, if it was said to them, don't do that. Don't spread this corruption in this beautiful, pristine religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They will say, إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُصْلِحُونَ. You know? إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُصْلِحُونَ. We are only doing good. We are only doing civilization. You know? We're trying to have friends everywhere. We're becoming an ally to this superpower, this superpower. Allah says, that is spreading corruption. That is not good. They have no shame of declaring self-righteous and saying, we are the one who is doing good. So in all our countries, people who are writing poison in the newspaper, in the kids' book, in the movie, in the music, Muslim names. Their names Ahmed and Muhammad and Abdullah, you'd be amazed. Abdul Khaliq and Abdul Bari and Abdul Wahhab and this and that. And you ask them, what is this? They will say this ayah. Innama nahnu, we're trying to, you know, have civilization. We're trying to make our country strong. We're trying to make our country look good. That's what this mentioned 1,400 years ago. These are not new. Allah says, they say that, you know, they are doing good. Allah says, Al-Ala, innahum humu mufsidun. No way. Listen to this. They are the corrupted one. They are the one who spread corruption. They cause corruption. They create corruption. Walakin, listen also, la yash'arun. La yash'arun. They actually don't acknowledge it. Don't realize it. They're so brainwashed. They're so brainwashed that when they spend millions of dollars on something haram in Muslim countries, they think they're doing good. They think they're doing good. Allah even goes further. Because this is when you're talking to them, don't do that, they will say, yeah, we're trying our best, we're doing good to save the country, to bring it through. Yeah? Allah says, even in their private meetings, which is nobody knew about it, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam obviously doesn't even know who they are. Now the Quran exposing them. Yeah? وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ آمِنُوا كَمَا آمَنَ النَّاسِ قَالُوا أَنُؤْمِنُوا كَمَا آمَنَ السُّفَهَاءِ أَلَا إِنَّهُمْ هُمُ السُّفَهَاءِ وَلَكِنْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Allah says, even in their private gathering, when they sit together and all of them, they knew they're all hypocrite, they're all fake, they will say, why don't we just become like everybody else? Some of them will have a little bit of conscience. And he will say, why don't we become like all the Sahaba, like all the Muhajirin and Ansar? The common answer is, will we believe like this fool? Fool who lost their home, lost their land, lost their business. That's Allah exposing them what they say in private to be in the Quran. Subhanallah. So this insult, it was aimed at the Sahaba. It was aimed at the Sahaba. Listen to this one, we'll finish with this one inshallah. Incredible. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes to the aid of the Sahaba and he replies on their behalf. Anybody that attack Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or the Sahaba, Allah himself answers. Allah takes it on himself to defend them till the end of time. Because these are radiyallahu anhum wa radu anhu. These are the favorite people of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَسَيَكْفِيكَهُمُ اللَّهِ. Allah will suffice you. Allah will defend you. Allah will look after you. They want to kill you, they want this, they want this. Allah will take care of it. When this ayah was revealed, the Prophet ﷺ came out, it was battlefield time. And he told all his bodyguard, go to sleep. Whoa, this is the general of the whole army. And he's sending his guard to sleep. He says, yes, there is an ayah revealed, Allah will protect me. Nobody will reach, nobody will harm me. This ayah itself is just a proof that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the true messenger. Any fake prophet, they get more guard, more people to protect him. He can't reach their place. Yeah? But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent his private guard to sleep. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when these people say, they want us to believe like all this fool who lost their home, lost their business, just to come to, from their honorable, noble tribe in Mecca to come to Medina, now they're homeless, now they're sleeping in the masjid, now they have not even food to eat, they put a stone in their stomach. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ala innahum humul sufaha. No way, listen, these are truly fool. They are the truly fool one. ولكن لا يعلم, but they don't know it. When they gonna know it? When they meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So insulting the Sahaba made Allah come to their protection. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from insulting the Sahaba. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from saying anything wrong about the Sahaba. The Sahaba were human being. The Sahaba were human being. The Sahaba were human being. Yeah? They were human being. Chosen by Allah to be in the company of His best messenger. The Sahaba were chosen by Allah to live at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. Yes, they were human beings. Yes, maybe they made something that's, incorrect. But who has the right to correct them? Someone above them or at the same level. Not under them like us. Either Allah can correct them. The Messenger correct them. They themselves can correct each other. But us, after 1,000 years, so you can't do that. It's not befitting. It's not right. Some scholars say Allah protected us from living at the time of the Sahaba because we don't know if we were there what mistake would have done ourselves. Allah protected us and made us live in 2016. So we should not be worrying about the time of the Sahaba. Says, okay, they've done what they've done. It's up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as a belief, we say all the Sahaba, 100%. 100%, all of them, 100%, they are perfect believers. 100%, no exception. Anybody that saw the Prophet ﷺ and believed in him, for us, 100% leader, 100% believer, 100% in Jannah. Not up to us now to find out, did he do this correct, did he do this right, did he do this wrong? Who are you to get the paper of your professor and start to mark it? People will laugh at you. If you go into primary school and you grab some paper from, PhD or thesis and says, show me, what you've done? No. You're making a fool of yourself. So people today who insult the Sahaba, people today who criticize the Sahaba, people today who says, We can do like this, are threading in a very dangerous ground. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be against them. Allah himself will come and protect the name of the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather us with the Sahaba in the best place in Jannah. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Jazakum Allah khairan. Subhanak Allah wa hamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. We continue inshallah next time. Yes, that's correct, mashallah.
Just him,
or? Just him. Yes, yes. Hudhaifa ibn al-Yaman. Hudhaifa ibn al-Yaman. His name is Hafidh Sir Rasulullah. Yeah? He used. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had a role for every Sahabi. Every Sahabi had a role. So, one of them, this was the intelligence, was with Hudhaifa. So, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when the names were revealed to him, he gave them all to Hudhaifa. Speciality of Hudhaifa, he says, people used to ask about good things, and I used to ask about bad things. People used to ask the Prophet ﷺ about good things. Jannah, and what is the best good deeds, and this and that. But he used to ask, after you die, what will happen to the Ummah? You know, are we going to lose Islam? Is the Quran going to be, you know, changed? Is the Kaaba going to be destroyed? Is, you know, the hypocrites will lead us and rule us. So all this out-of-the-box question that nobody think about in a good time, he used to go many, many folds away from the good time to worse time. Says, what will happen then? How we behave? How we react? Prophet ﷺ, that's why the Prophet gave him the name of the hypocrite. And he says, to keep it to yourself. So the Sahaba, after the Prophet ﷺ passed away, they will wait for Hudhaifa. If Hudhaifa prayed the janazah, they will join and pray the janazah. If Hudhaifa didn't pray the janazah, it means that this is a hypocrite. They won't pray it. So Hudhaifa has the name of the, you know, the hypocrites. If the one person died in Medina, Hudhaifa will pray if the person is not on the list. This was the only way they know who was in the list of Hudhaifa. Sahaba pressed him so hard to tell them the name, he wouldn't. Even Umar ibn Khattab actually tried to get the name. He says, Allah, I won't tell no human being after you. Can't. Yeah.
Okay, that's one. This one hadith, can you briefly explain about this one hadith? The dunya is a prison to the believer.
Mm-hmm.
The dunya is paradise.
Yeah. Ad-dunya sijnul mu'min wa jannatul kafir. Yeah? The Prophet said, ad-dunya, this life, the life of this world, is like a prison for the believer. But it's like paradise for the disbeliever. So the dunya for the believer is restricted. You're not free. You're not like in a prison, you know, just think of yourself, you're restricted. You're not free to drink whatever, to say whatever, to eat whatever, to earn whatever, yeah? But the disbeliever, they can earn whatever. Gambling, lottery, scratchy, wool market, stock, whatever it is, they can sell drugs, sell tobacco, sell whatever it is, sell weapons, and they make money and they don't feel guilty at all. So that's one of the meaning of the hadith, that we are not free 100% to behave as we like. Yeah. Another one scholar, I'm not sure if Ibn Taymiyyah, was asked the question by a non-Muslim. Ibn Taymiyyah, you know, was just a grand scholar, very big scholar. So that poor non-Muslim, very poor non-Muslim, he came to him and said to him, your messenger, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but we say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, ad-dunya sijnul mu'min. This dunya is like prison for the believer. And like paradise for this believer. Look at you. You like in paradise. And I'm like in prison. Yeah? I'm homeless, sick and poor and can't even, you know, find one meal a day. And you eating in palaces and meeting the kings and royals, and look at the crowd around you. So the scholar said to him, what you are in today, he says to the poor man, what you are in today, all this poverty and all the sickness, it is paradise compared to hell. If you die as a disbeliever and end up in hell, this will be like paradise. At least you can breathe. At least you know you're walking around. And what I'm in today, if I make it to Jannah, is like hell. All these raw palaces and all this crowd is nothing compared to the joy of Jannah. So this is one of the meaning of the hadith. The dunya is restricted for us, akhira is open. It's like this dunya is like, as I call it, always to the kids, I give them the example, it's like a marathon race. Yeah, it's like a marathon. You look at the people in the track. Are they free? No, they're not free. They can't just sit down and chat and have a cigarette. No, they're going for it. When they become free, if they want it, then they can jump up and down, lie on the ground, sit down, get to the camera, take the whatever it is they can do after they win the ticket. And the same thing for the Muslim. It's a, Allah says, وَسَارِعُوا وَسَابِقُوا. One scholar says, very nice comment. He says, in the dunya, all the speeds are controlled. You know the speeds, road speed, train speed, plane speed, everything just controlled, they have speed limits. Except the road to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, وَسَارِعُوا, there's no limit. Just keep going as fast as you can. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this dunya, you know, like the platform to catapult us into Jannah, into the best place in Jannah. Ameen, Rabbi Ameen. Jazakallah.